Okay, Nick, I want to get to you. Do we have anything from our fact checkers?
We do. We have some short, pithy questions and a fact check. You asked earlier, what was the number of people that were on the Affordable Care Act, or uninsured, rather, before the Affordable Care Act went into effect? And what about afterwards? Stephen Larson has been coordinating these facts for us over here with our friends at the UMKC Library. And the what was the results of that?
The results were, Nick, that in quarter one of 2008 in the United States, that 14.6% of uninsured Americans were living. In 2013, that rate rose to 18%. But in quarter one of 2015, that rate dropped to 11.4%. And keep in mind that the population of the United States increased greatly in that seven-year period. The source is Gallup.
Our fact check is working for you. We have a pithy question here from Jane. Why are states allowing for-profit publicly traded insurance companies take over Medicaid, making sure even less goes to the poor?
Who would like to start with that one? Taryn, you want to take a shot at that one?
Sure. You have a dynamic where in a lot of states, under old Medicaid, that there was a one-size-fits-none, that the state administered the health program. There was no guarantees of certain kinds of access for individuals. You heard Diamante's story, and as well, Ms. Sebelius talked about the lack of access for health professionals, dentists, doctors, specialists. So a lot of states have moved into the direction of, we want to have more competing private plans. A lot of states that do this still have a default that if people want to stay in old Medicaid, that they can stay in old Medicaid. With the idea being that if people have several different private choices, and the individuals then have a way to go and vote with their feet and go to another plan if they're not getting the services that they allow. I think that kind of choice is much better in Medicaid. Frankly, you heard my own story. I wish I had those kind of options in the county that I live in Florida. But instead, because of this law, my choices have been limited. I now have one carrier, and the plans that are available to me are twice as much as they used to be and have much higher deductibles. So while Ms. Sebelius can talk about the fact that health premiums have been flattening, so have incomes, and deductibles have been skyrocketing. They grew 9% this year.
Well, health premiums aren't flattening, but I want to disagree with Tarren on this a little bit, because old Medicaid, which I should be more precise and say fee-for-service Medicaid, as opposed to Medicaid that uses insurers. Fee-for-service Medicaid is just the government writing checks to doctors and hospitals and drug companies. And Medicaid managed care is the government writing checks to insurance companies. Now, I'm not sure that one of these is better than the other. I think you just end up with a different set of bad outcomes in each case. If you pay Medicaid providers for each service, then you'll get more services, more wasteful services. If the government pays insurance companies, then you end up spending a lot more. I think the questioner is right, and it might go to profits. It's this really interesting dynamic where, you know, Medicaid and Medicare faces the same problem. In the Medicare Advantage program, if the government's going to pay an insurance company to cover me, Michael Cannon, how does the government know how much to pay? They got to come up with some number. What's an actuarially fair premium? Those things we're so afraid of in private markets. What's an actuarially fair premium that the government should pay an insurance company to cover me? And they try to mimic that, but the government never gets it right. Not in Medicaid, not in Medicare. So in Medicaid, what happens is they'll, you know, say they get the prices too low that they pay to the Medicaid managed care companies. For someone like me, say they pay according to the average risk of Medicaid enrollees. Well, that encourages the insurance companies to avoid everyone who gonna cost them more than average, all the sick people, and encourages them to court and enroll all the people who are healthier than average, including the one-third of people who are eligible for Medicaid and not enrolled and weren't costing the government a dime. Those people, if the insurance company goes out with, you know, offering them gym memberships or whatever it can offer them and to encourage them to enroll in Medicaid, can increase Medicaid enrollments, increase Medicaid spending, all and maybe shirking on care for the high-cost folks. And you get the same dynamic in the Medicaid program that we're seeing in the exchanges, because the exchanges also use government price controls to pay insurance companies. And this is the process that I'm talking about, of people not having secure access to coverage. First of all, it's it does increase Medicaid spending. By enrolling in Medicaid, a lot of people who wouldn't otherwise be there and don't need to be enrolled in Medicaid because they don't because they're healthy. But you're also creating a system where you're encouraging the insurance companies to avoid, dump, and mistreat the sick. And this is not the sort of secure health insurance we want people to have.
Dan, you want to jump in here?
I mentioned one thing. You'd mentioned the a portion going to for-profit companies. That's called the medical loss ratio. I'm sure Secretary Sebelius is aware of that as the former insurance commissioner. That's basically saying, in this case, there's a federal regulation coming down the pike that says 85% of the premium has to be spent on medical services. The rest can be profit, administration, related matters. And that doesn't matter if you're for-profit, not-for-profit, or whatever. So those are all things to consider. As providers, we obviously want that medical loss ratio to be as high as possible. We'd rather have it be 90, but 85 is what the federal regulations are going to propose. What's important, though, is what they do is golden. I mentioned the fact that you've got this enormously disproportionate amount of cost coming out of very few people. Well, you need to learn how to manage those people real well. It was mentioned the Oregon study. I think both of you talked about that a bit. The Oregon study essentially came out of an unusual fact situation in Oregon, where they had a situation where you could go to the Oregon Department of Medicaid, and because of particular circumstances that aren't important here, they would randomly assign some people to Medicaid, and some people wouldn't get it. It might not be exactly fair, but it was the perfect study to compare the two. And what they found a few things where having Medicaid was beneficial, for example, depression and the like, but there were a number of things where the conclusion that was highly publicized was it really didn't matter if you had a Medicaid card or not, because they would look at indicators like how well is your blood pressure controlled, how well is your blood sugar controlled, and there wasn't a big difference. Basically, this started in 2008, I think went for four or five years. Now, the point that I draw from that is giving somebody a card isn't enough to get them to use the system correctly. You have to go in there and teach them how to use that card. And so it's not enough to just give them a card. I think that's why the Oregon study found what it did. But somebody, be that providers, health plans, or somebody else, needs to come in and take the long, slogging process of teaching people how to utilize the system well. And I do not see a lot of that going on now.
Nick, you want to add?
There's a lot of economics questions, of course, and we're answering those. But the most burning question of all, do you know what that is of this whole pack? And it's coming from Lisa in Merriam, Brad in Kansas City, and Don in Leavenworth. It is killing me. What is Kathleen Sebelius doing since she left the Obama administration? And would she run for political office again in Kansas?
No.
Okay, I can feel that one if you want.
That's right. I think we can go to the next question.
What are you doing now?
I would say I'm doing a portfolio of activities. I'm working directly with some companies in the healthcare space. Many of them are startups and have exciting ideas about better care or interesting innovative biomedical products. I'm working on a health project with the Aspen Institute. I am doing some speaking and some financial consulting and saying no to lots of things that I don't want to do, which is great.
Okay, look, I want to roll something by the panel here.
Hanging out with my grandson also, 3-year-old, very smart, wonderful.
And that is because we've talked a lot about what the Affordable Care Act did and didn't do. One thing we know it did, and I think that some people have dealt with it here a little more glibly than others, which is the elimination of the pre-existing condition problem, okay? Now, as somebody who, most of us who've been around insurance or had to deal with health insurance, we're not employed by a large company, we're health questions, we're not allowed to be answered in large groups. The rest of us sort of know this has been a recurring problem. The question is if you have a heart disease, if you have diabetes, if you had tuberculosis, if you had any large or small number of things going into the marketplace and getting insurance, if you could, was astronomically expensive and might be dropped after the next treatment.
That no longer is the case, is my understanding of the law. Is that and if you repeal the law, it's not like this is new. So if you repeal the law, how do you sort of get it back?
Well, I would dispute the premise that this law has eliminated discrimination against people with pre-existing conditions. And I want to tell you the story of two people, Ian Pearl and Shelby Rogers. Ian Pearl is a guy about my age, born not far from where I was born, in Jackson Heights, in Queens. And when I was graduating high school, I think, Ian began what has been now a couple decades in a wheelchair. He's got, I think, muscular dystrophy. He's confined to a wheelchair. He's on a respirator. His father, through his small business, had coverage. And his health plan dropped their plan, the plan that his father had, his father's business had, and reissued a new plan that said, that included all, it was basically the same plan, but they dropped the 24-hour nursing coverage benefit. Shelby Rogers happened to grow up close to where I grew up in McLean, Virginia. She has spinal muscular atrophy. She's also confined to a wheelchair. She needed help from a nurse to turn her over in bed at night lest she get pressure sores. She was covered by an Aetna plan through the Federal Employees Health Benefits Program. And her insurance company, Aetna, actually following the lead of other insurance companies, did the same thing, dropped that very expensive 24-hour nursing care benefit. Now, why did they do this? Is it because insurance companies are evil? Is it because they're greedy? Is it because it's because they were responding to the incentives in which they of the market in which they were operating? In New York and in the Federal Employees Health Benefits Program, you had these same provisions that you have in the ACA, the same sort of provisions that are supposed to end discrimination against people with pre-existing conditions. All they do is tell the insurance companies, you can't vary the premiums that you charge people based on their health status. But the discrimination comes out in other ways. As I said, it comes out in efforts to avoid, dump, and mistreat the sick, because if you can only charge a person this much of a premium, and they, you know, a $10,000 premium, and they cost you, say, $400,000, that's a $390,000 incentive to do the sorts of things that they did to Ian Pearl and Shelby Rogers. Now, this
You're saying that the I want to jump in here. And does the current law, as I understand it, keep something like that from happening?
Well, and as Kathleen knows, the pre-existing condition provisions in the ACA create these sort of perverse incentives. They know that it does because much of the ACA is devoted to regulations designed to stop insurance companies from responding to these incentives that those price controls create. And Kathleen was responsible for implementing a lot of these, a lot of the marketing restrictions and the plan design. They didn't want insurance companies marketing themselves in ways that appeal to the healthy and not the sick, or they didn't want the plans to be designed in ways that appeal to the healthy and not the sick. But the way you know that this is baked into the cake of the ACA and the community rating laws in New York and in the Federal Employees Health Benefits Program is that those price controls reward insurance companies for this sort of behavior, even if it's unintentional. Even if they just happen to not invest enough in their call centers or claims payments, and that ends up driving their sickest patients crazy, and the healthy patients don't even notice, the ACA rewards them for that because the sickest patients go away and they get to keep the healthier patients and they make more money.
Okay, I take your point. Kathleen?
Well, I frankly am a little baffled. I don't know if Michael wants more regulation so insurance companies would have to have a mandatory set of benefits that they would have to provide. That was not part of the law. There are categories that everybody does, and then there's competition in the marketplace. 25% of the insurers who sold in the individual market year one were new. Another 25% came in year two. So there is competition in markets that used to have monopolies, and they have different ranges of benefits. But there is no question that underlying that is a law that says no longer, never, ever again can an insurance company lock somebody out, dump somebody out, or limit coverage based on a pre-existing health condition. That is part of the law that was never there before. It is in place now. Now, I can't speak to what in New York has had community rating for years. It had nothing to do with the ACA. It well preceded that. The federal employee benefit plan has a large group policy, some of which cover some benefits and some don't. There are choices that all federal employees have about what benefit suits your family. Both of those are not related to the ACA, but there is no question that for the first time ever in the United States, there is a law that says insurance companies cannot any longer discriminate against people with pre-existing conditions. They can buy insurance coverage, and that has never been part of the law.
But it's happening. It's happening in these benefit designs. And Kathleen said she doesn't know.
I want to get a question from Nick. We'll get back to that in a second. Nick, go ahead. What's next?
One of the things that characterizes this kind of event versus others is that we have fact checkers, Alan. And they've been getting lots and lots of fact checks coming in. Okay. And sometimes they can be sort of nitpicking on little details that is it worth interrupting the conversation for? But a lot of things have been said about an Oregon health study. And after Medicaid expansion there, was there really any difference in the healthcare outcomes? And it was stated on the panel that there wasn't any difference in the healthcare outcomes. But we're going to go back to our fact checkers who have been looking into that. Stephen Larson, what did you find? Would you mind standing up for us?
Sure can, Nick. So we actually found three very interesting differences between those who had Medicaid and those who were non-insured. Those who did have Medicaid found that they had increased use of healthcare services overall. It also raised their rates of diabetes detection and management and lowered rates of depressions in the enrollees by 30%.
Okay. What is the source for this?
The source is the New England Journal of Medicine.
Okay. Is that credible enough? Yes,
But it's incomplete. It's incomplete.
Well,
because the effects on patients don't include how much services did they use. That's really the effect on these guys, on the hospitals, and how much more money did they make off of Medicaid. Okay. But the three effects on patients were...
Michael, come on.
We understand that you disagree, and we understand what he just came out here with.
We don't fact checkers?
We
is that the rule?
No.
Journal of Medicine.
What we're going to do is we're going to ask Stephen to sort of look if there's anything else there while we're asking another question. What do you got for me, Nick?